Welcome to the Python with Andrew, where we look at some short, sharp lessons on Python. And today we're going to look at sets. This is the fourth data type in the collection series, where we've got lists, dictionaries, tuples, and sets. And if you look at the videos that I've produced, you can see that each one has a different type of use. We're going to look at sets. And quite frankly, sets are appealing as a data type because they match, if you like, mathematical set theory, not to make it more complex, but a lot of the actual functionality of sets in math. So that's quite good. But often people just stick to the easier ones like lists and dictionaries to represent data in Python. So I'm going to give you a bit of a run through on some of the basics of sets. Let's jump over to the code. And the first thing I'll say is that where sets are different to lists and dictionaries, et cetera, number one, it's unordered, right? So you can't rely on the ordering. And in fact, for a set, it does not matter. It's just a collection of objects inside that. It's also immutable. In other words, you cannot change any of the elements. You can remove them, you can add them. You can't change the element. And it does not allow duplicates. So if you create a set that has duplicates, the set will actually delete the extra one. And last but not least, you can't access the set through an index. I'll show you an example of that. But typically we look at elements in or objects inside of a set. We don't go through and look for object one or object zero or object five. In fact, we can't because they're unordered, so we can't rely on the index. So a few differences, but there's also a lot of similarity. If you look at this set here, it looks just like a dictionary. It's pretty hard to see the difference between that and, say, a dictionary or a list, other than the curly brackets and other than we've got no key value there. And if I print the set out, no surprise, you'll see that the set comes across. And then this is the way we loop through the elements of a set. We must do a loop through each item. For example, I cannot print the set one zeroth item. I can't do that. If I try and do that, I'll get an error because the object, we cannot index the object, or in the error message here, we cannot subscript. And that's because sets are just a collection, they're not ordered. So you can't go through them one by one using an index. You must use the for loop or while loop example, this one above here. Now, where sets become quite powerful is when we talk about adding sets or deleting sets or using set theory. So if I create a second set here, created two lots of sets there. If I create a second set here, and imagine set one is, if you like, a group of people, maybe a class of people, let's say four people, and set two is another class. And you can see that both Peter and John are in both sets or both classes or both groups of friends, whereas Anne and Jill and Marie and Brian are not. They're in one set only. Okay, so if we print, first of all, the intersection of set one with set two, all right, you can see the format is we're using a method on set one, saying set one's our base. I want to know the intersection, or in English, let me write that in proper. Who is in both, right? So who is in both groups? For example, who are in both group of friends or who are in both classes? And so if I run that, you'll see that John and Peter are in both groups. So that's intersection. The next one is, what about set one dot who are in either? who is in either group, right? So that's a scenario where we're saying, I've got two classes, but what's the list of all the people, all the students in that class? So if I look at this and I run this, you'll see I've now got a list of not four students or four people, I've got a list of six people, all right? And that's a useful thing when we're combining groups and we want a total list. Now, remember, it will be unique. Let me just fix up my spelling mistake there. And the last one is, what happens if we want to know the difference between set one and set two? So that would mean who is in set one? Who's in set two that is not in set one? Let's see if I got that the right way around. All right, so who is in, who is in set one that is not in set two? I got that the wrong way around. All right, so that takes away the people that are in both groups of set one. All right, so that's Anne and Jill who are only in set one. They're only in that class and not in the second class. So just with those three methods, and there's a few more, add, remove, and length, we've seen those sort of methods in other collection data types. But these three are unique to the set data type and quite powerful when you want to combine groups together, but you want to avoid duplicates, or you want to see who's in both, or you want to see who's in one group and not in the other. So it's a nice, short, sharp way of using that data type with groups of people or groups of things. And again, it matches nicely to, if you like, if any of you have done some mathematics where you've got sets and done some set theory, basic set theory in mathematics. So it marries that. Must say, you don't see it a lot in Python. So we won't be using it much in our applications, but it is one to think about and can be quite powerful. I think often the best use of this is when we want to add things, but we only want to keep unique items in that list. So in that sense, it's quite good, a bit like tuples. Okay, that's all for this particular video on sets. Again, if you do like these videos, please subscribe or do share them with your friend to help them out, help you on your journey of Python. We'll continue to look at, if you like, more complex version bits of Python and do snippet of, if you like, little applications or little programs that show these in use.